Alright guys, what you're looking at is video from the BGA Blue Gray Alliance 150th Chickamauga Reenactment. It was in late August or early September of 2013, so almost 2 years ago now. And I was finally able to get the over 3.5 hours of footage that I had from that condensed down into something that you guys could watch. As you can see by how the video's been going so far, the entire video is going to be this bird's eye view. It's really awesome. It gives you a larger feel for the battlefield, which was almost a half a mile wide. And there are just really some awesome views throughout the whole length of this video. The battle itself gets hot and then it relaxes a bit. And it does that throughout the video, so it's definitely going to be worth the 30 minutes just to sit and watch, because this kind of reenactment doesn't happen very often. And what made the 150th Chickamauga unique was the overall organization of the event. It was highly organized, mainly because it was being filmed for a movie and for stock footage for documentaries and such. So since it was being filmed, it was highly organized, and there was a lot of authenticity stressed throughout the entire event. As you'll see throughout the whole video, there's going to be a lot more battalion-sized movements that you typically don't see at events, and there's also going to be a really awesome signal corps, and you'll see a lot of signal flags being used throughout the entire event, which is just something that you don't see very often. So it was a real treat, and it made it even better that it was such a gorgeous area, Martin Cove Farms in Georgia, and the weather was beautiful, and there were about 6,000 reenactors there, and just all the stars aligned to make a really awesome event. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go through this video, and we're going to watch the 150th Chickamauga, and I'm going to talk about reenacting in general. A lot of you guys have sent me your questions and whatnot about how to get involved in it, just different questions about reenacting. So I figured this would be a great opportunity to go through and watch a good event with you guys and just talk about reenacting in general. You see there are the Iron Grays going into the cornfield. Their uniforms are so dark gray that it's almost jet black. It's a pretty awesome shot. The historic Battle of Chickamauga was fought on September 19th and 20th, 1863, near Chickamauga Creek in northern Georgia, right there along the Tennessee border. It involved almost 120,000 units, and that was pretty evenly split between U.S. and C.S., which was unusual to have a pretty even matching. So the battle was ultimately a Confederate victory, with each side losing in excess of 15,000 killed, wounded, captured, or missing. Now, I don't know if you guys can hear that, but that is not a jet going overhead. That's actually the sound of the artillery. Martin Cove Farms is in a beautiful little bowl of a valley that has tall hills with long angled slopes that surround the entire valley, and when the artillery goes off that are on the extreme sides of this field here, the sound wave, the percussion wave, just rolls through that bowl. It runs the bowl and it just sounds awesome. Like I said, it kind of sounds like a jet, but it's actually the percussion from the artillery running that bowl that Martin Cove Farms sits down inside. It's really cool when you hear it. I wish the camera was able to pick it up better, but you will hear it throughout the video. There's a pretty awesome smoke ring. That actually happens quite a bit with not only artillery, but muskets also. Though it happens more frequently with the artillery. So a question I get asked a lot is, what kind of people are in reenacting? What demographic does it draw from? I think the common misconception is it's full of a bunch of either hillbillies, nerds, political extremists, you know, those types. And while I'm sure those types probably exist, you know, it's a mathematic inevitability when you have 40 to 50,000 estimated Civil War reenactors in the United States, they would definitely be in the extreme minority. I've been to every major national event since 2011, and the majority of people that I meet that are reenactors are going to be your former military, former law enforcement, or active military, active law enforcement. I would say that's at least half of everybody that I've met through reenacting. That's going to be their background. Another percentage is going to be your generational reenactor. They were in it because, you know, their family's been in it for a long time, because reenacting goes all the way back to just shortly after the Civil War ended. So it's been going on for a long time. So the other group you're going to have is there's the people that came to events like this and got interested through it that. So there's a lot of first timers. There's a lot of old timers. There's a lot of writers and historians who get into reenacting to be able to write more factual and more, how would you say, more depth into their novels and whatnot. I know quite a few authors that have used their experiences through reenacting to provide some depth and perspective in their writing. So I believe reenacting and reenactor authors are definitely better than people who have never done it, because there's just things that you learn and experience in recreating what was that until you do it on this kind of massive scale, it's just difficult to understand. So, like I said, it draws from a huge crowd, and I would say 95 to 98% of everybody who I've met through reenacting have been upstanding people. Yeah, it's a testosterone-driven hobby, sport, as you could say, and you are going to meet your jerks out there, but they're few and far between. I really enjoy the social aspect and the people that I've met through reenacting. So if you're worried about that kind of thing, which some people evidently are, because I get asked about it a lot, don't be. There's really great people involved in this. And if you sat and thought about it, you know, you'd understand that. I mean, think of what it takes to become a reenactor, to come out and do an event like what you're looking at right now. You know, if it was run by a bunch of clowns and animals, stuff like this could never work out. It takes too much organization. Question I'm asked a lot is, what's the cost of getting into reenactment? A lot of people will quote you that $1,500 to $2,000 mark, and what that is your uniform and weapon cost. You know, for your uniform, standard equipment, and a musket, it's typically going to cost you about $2,000. When people hear that number, they kind of shirk and they kind of lose interest. But I'm here to tell you right now that expense is going to be spread out over wide period of time. If you're thinking about getting into reenacting, you need to first join a unit, and from there you will learn that you absolutely do not want to go out and buy a bunch of stuff before you start. Your unit's going to be fully stocked, and they're going to give you loaner equipment while you learn what's correct, because there's a lot of stuff out there that's horribly incorrect. You're going to learn what's correct. You're going to learn what's correct to your specific unit. And like I said, you're going to be using loaner equipment for years. It took me, I estimate it took me a good 3 years to get my kit to where it would be kind of quote-unquote complete. I mean, as reenactors know, our kits are never complete. We're always adding to them. But I would say I had a good kit in about 3 years. So, and that's, once you've got it, you've got it. After that, the only cost is travel. I'm with a Texas unit, as I reside in Texas, so we have to drive quite a bit further than a lot of you guys in the more eastern states. But for me, you know, we get together with our group, typically 10 to 20 guys, depending on the reenactment, and we either get a rental van or we get in a couple of Suburbans. We split gas prices. It's usually like $75 to drive from Texas to wherever in the east, you know, be it Louisiana, Georgia, Tennessee, Virginia, Pennsylvania. Typically it's about $75 plus another, I don't know, $40 for food. And because you're not having to pay for in a hotel, you're reenacting, you're camping out on the field. So, you know, once you have that, once you have your gear locked in, you're really set. And I gotta say, I've seen some parts of the country through reenacting that I would have never had the opportunity to see otherwise. Martin Cove Farms, what you're looking at right here, perfect example. I got to see some absolutely gorgeous ground out here that, had I not been a reenactor, I would have never been allowed to walk the grounds. This is a historic area, and they don't just allow people to traipse through this farm. So I got to see parts of this farm that just the average guy doesn't get to see. And that's true throughout the country. You know, I've been to, like I said, Alabama, I've been to Louisiana, I've been to Tennessee, I've been to Georgia, I've been to West Virginia, I've been to Virginia, I've been to Maryland, I've been to Pennsylvania. I've been to all these states, and really on the cheap, completely thanks to reenacting. Here we have several battalions getting ready to form up and do a really awesome wheel. This is more of those larger battalion movements I've been talking about. We got two battalions that are going to wheel and go into a line of battle without getting hit. It's a really difficult move. For people that only do this part-time on the weekends, they execute it excellently. Beautiful execution. This little area around this ditch is about to turn into a hornet's nest. Awesome memories out here. Another question I get asked a lot is people want to know how to get into reenacting, and the best advice I can give you is if your state had anything to do with the Civil War, you probably have a unit fairly close to you, and your best resource is Google. Just Google Civil War reenactment groups and put your state name there, put your county name, and Google will help you out tremendously. Another resource is to go to a reenactment. You can go to a reenactment and anytime the actual battles aren't going on, you're going to have reenactors walking around. You can always pull one aside. Reenactors are what is in their name, actors. They love to talk, and they will pretty much answer any questions you have about how to get involved. So that's a couple of ways, like I said, that you could get involved. Your state doesn't have to have been involved in the Civil War. I've met reenactors from all over the country and even all over the world. This event, the 150th Chickamauga and the 150th Gettysburg, I met people who come over from England and Italy. So you definitely don't have to be, but if your state wasn't involved in the Civil War, you're going to be looking at a little more travel. In my opinion, it's worth it, though. Another question I've asked a lot, and it kind of has like a negative connotation, is people ask, well, why do we need reenacting, or why reenact? And like I said, they'll ask it in kind of a negative way. And I personally believe, through my own experiences in becoming a reenactor, that reenacting gives you a perspective that there's absolutely no way to get that kind of perspective through any other outlet. There's no amount of reading, there's no amount of documentary watching, there's no amount of movies, you know, bad as an example as it is, there's no amount of that that you can read, watch, or do that will equate to dressing up in the full kit, the full weight of the uniform, going out for a weekend, you know, living off of rations of the time, which not everybody does, but some do, experiencing the heat, experiencing the smoke, you know, you're experiencing everything you can, you know, shy of bullets and privation, and that just gives you a certain perspective that no historian or nobody who has ever experienced anything like it will be able to relate to. And personally, it's my belief that that's how a lot of the crap that you hear from places like the History Channel and certain documentaries gets peddled, is because people just repeat things without ever having experienced them. You guys don't know this, but this was just a beautiful, beautiful day. It was just one of those once-in-a-lifetime days in reenacting where it was like a perfect 65 to 70 degrees outside. And that just, if you're an actor, you know that just rarely happens. It's either scorching hot or freezing cold. And this day was just beautiful. Side of the battle. It's not a different day, it's the same day. Just different lighting. I apologize for the sharp transition, but there's Texas. Anytime you see that Texas flag, you know I'm not very far away. The Chickamauga was unique in that it had a really awesome night battle, which will be coming up on here shortly. And with the night comes one of my favorite events at reenacting, the formal ball.
Oh, it's on the R.O.
The little pops of light that look like fireflies that you're seeing in the distance is musketry. Unfortunately, the camera lens couldn't pick it up, it was too dark. You just see it as like little fireflies in the distance. And you can hear the ball getting started in the background.
But within us.
Now, what you're going to hear here in a second is an old guy talking in the background. I'm going to let him narrate for a minute because he's actually pretty fun to listen to. So I'm going to step out of his way. Listen to this guy.
He was buried underneath a dead soldier, and he went insane. And his screams alerted the people to come and rescue him. But his spirit supposedly still haunted this place so bad they had to call an exorcist. But they grabbed that wood cross and protect that home. They ain't had no problem with it. It's really strange. Now there's something about these balls y'all need to understand. A lot of these here soldiers just got all fancy. They ain't out there fighting. They come here to show off and have people take pictures. You'll see them with the feathers in their hats and shiny brass buttons. And a lot of these women, they don't, you know, you won't see these kind of people in our village. This is just Charlotte O'Hara. They probably don't know beans about this battle, but they dress up and bounce around like you had the picture took.
So we're a pretty good way to the battlefield.
Not really. Here, this field was this ground was actually covered by both armies during the field.
Really?
The Yankees are camping this weekend.
Yeah,
the original road runs right through their camp. The troops on both sides use this area. That's why this whole cove is an archaeologically sensitive area. In the state of Georgia, you can't do no digging on this ground. That's why we can't build fire pits.
That guy's hilarious. I'm glad I got him in the background. But anyway, like I said, I really enjoy these formal balls. They're just a good way to break up the event, usually right in the middle of the event. And this is what guys used to do for fun back in the day, guys. I mean, they didn't have TV or your devices or any of that stuff. They went out and they socialized, they danced, and they read, they sang. So it's kind of nice being able to unplug and go back to the old ways. So, all right, here we are, back to business. This is the second day. Sweet smoke rings. You know, while we're on that topic of being disconnected, that's another question that I do get asked a lot is what I personally enjoy about reenacting. And that's going to be one of the big ones is we live in such a go-go world these days and we're so interconnected and we have a hard time just breaking free of everything that keeps us so interconnected. And that is one of the biggest things that I love about reenacting more than anything is when I go to an event, I'm able to unplug from my work, from my email, from my phone. You know, from Friday to Sunday afternoon, I'm completely disconnected. I'm living as a primitive man in the 1860s with a group of really awesome guys. And the other awesome thing about it is, you know, when we're with each other, we have each other's full attention. You know, we're out here in a primitive environment. There's not all the distractions. So there's a lot of the stories around the campfire and personal talk and just, like I said, relating just personal stories. And you have people's undivided attention because there's literally nothing else that can pull people. And it's just a feeling that you don't get very many places anymore. At least I don't, even in my own family. So that's going to be one of the major things that I love about reenacting. And the other thing is the camping aspect of it, you know, that you get to go out and camp primitively. You get to, you know, go out and burn powder in your musket. You get to see these awesome events that have been put together that allow you guys to come out and do this kind of things. And you get to interact with the people and the spectators. So there's just no end to things that I absolutely love about reenacting. Another big thing that it does for me is I feel personally that I get drained, you know, through working for months and months at a time. I get, you know, personally drained, and going reenacting, like I said, you're with a large group of guys and you're doing a testosterone-fueled activity, I guess is the best way to say it. And it just seems to recharge your batteries. Makes you feel like a man again and feel like you can get out there and conquer the world or whatever. So what I'm trying to describe to you is just the feeling of, like, I guess the feeling of the advance. You know, even though it's a reenactment, you're still kind of beating the odds together, kind of, you know, coming together in a common purpose. You know, like I said earlier in the video, when you're reenacting, it's usually extreme temperatures and you're out there in the heat and the elements, wool uniform, and there's nothing like, you know, completely helping each other out and being together with such a large group of guys and stepping forward, stepping off, and marching forward in common purpose, even though that purpose is just to recreate the past. There's no way for me to fully explain it to a guy that hasn't been there, how unifying that can be. So, I mean, that's the best way I can summarize it. I wouldn't trade my experiences for the world. There was actually one night after the ball here at Martin Cove Farm, after this 4-wall war, I was walking along the road in front of one of these fields back to our campsite, and it was a beautifully clear night, and the stars were so bright, and I could see the band of the Milky Way, and I just finished, you know, with the formal ball and everything, met a lot of awesome people, talked with a lot of really good people, and I just looked up into the sky, and I was like, man, I hope I never forget tonight. And it was, like I said, I wouldn't trade those memories for the world. So here we're coming down to the end. They're going to assault Snodgrass, which is where the Union is entrenched there. And they ultimately pushed them off the field. And like I said, the Battle of Chickamauga was ultimately a Confederate victory. Now, since we're coming down to the end here, let me tell you a little secret. What you'll see after the reenactment is over is a lot of people make a mad dash to get off the field because you got, you know, 10,000 reenactors plus all the spectators plus all the support staff, vendors, all kinds of people trying to make a mad dash to get out of there before the traffic gets bad. So what I do is I pack as light and authentically as I can, meaning I only take what I can actually carry. Now that means I sleep out in the elements more, but the advantage of it is I have everything on me during this last battle, and literally as soon as this battle is over, I just do an about face after we're dismissed, and I walk off the battlefield. So I'm able to skip a lot of the traffic. So if you're gonna get involved in the reenactment, there's a little secret for you. Go the final push. And there they are retreating. And what you're not seeing is to the far extreme left, the Union line is folding in also, because in this particular battle, the main action is going on a little further to the left. So the line is folding in on itself, and there's actually more people deployed to the left. So some of you may be looking at it like, why are they retreating? But you're not seeing the folding effect that's going on. And that's it. the end of the battle. Like I said, this is where everybody makes a mad dash for the vehicles and tries to get out of there before the traffic gets ridiculous, so. Well guys, that's pretty much it. I appreciate those of you who have stayed with me here to the end. If you're interested in seeing more stuff like this, go ahead and go check me out on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. I upload to Instagram every day, and I also upload a lot of these reenactment pics. So, like I said, thanks for watching, and I'll see you all out there.